Andrea Comlosi is professor in the Department of Economics and Social History at the University of Vienna in Austria, where she is coordinating the Global History and Global Studies programs. She has published on labor, on migration, on borders, and on uneven development on a regional European and global context. The reason why we thought her expertise would be invaluable for the show is that is her book, Work the Last 1,000 Years, which was published by Verso in 2018. And in the book, she is tracing the complexity and also the contradictory nature of work throughout history. Andrea Comlosi in her book demonstrates that understandings of work have varied sometimes quite radically across times and across geographies. And by looking at labor history across the globe from roughly the 13th until the 21st centuries, Andrea Comlosi is exploring the coexistence of multiple forms of labor. There is paid labor, there is unpaid labor, there's free labor, and there's forced labor. And she also reveals how hidden forms of unpaid and also hyper-exploited labor can often go unnoticed, and yet they are the key to the functioning of the capitalist world system.
So, yes, when I was reading your book, I saw parallels between, on the one hand, the self-sufficient household around 1700 that were in the countryside and they were producing and crafting goods under a very central control of the merchant. And then on the other hand, I think I found it a similar phenomenon now in the 21st century, where you have all these people who are also working from home, but they are working for platforms such as Amazon Mechanical Turk or Fiverr for creative freelance workers. So would you also make this kind of comparison between the work from home before the Industrial Revolution and what is happening now?
No, I think it makes sense to compare these situations, but also to see the differences. Because when we speak of the 18th century, so starting in 1700, that was the shift, the transition from the, let's say, craft system, the guild system, to the industrial age, but there were not yet factories. There was no urban labor supply, because the urban craftsmen were working in guilds and so on. So when a businessman, an employer, wanted to set up a mass production, and he always needed the government's support in doing so, in the Habsburg monarchy, it was called, he needed a privilege to set up a manufacture without machines yet, not a centralized manufacture, but a decentral manufacture relying on putting out the work into the households of the people, especially in the countryside. And this was an advantage. It was a necessity for the employer, because otherwise he couldn't have set up an industrial mass production. This was very common in textiles, but you can also find it in various metal works, woodworks, glassworks, and so on. But textile is really the most important branch where this putting out production employed hundreds, thousands of people who were performing the work in their cottages, in their farmhouses, and so on. So for the it also had advantages for the workers, because they could combine their agricultural work, their cottages' work, and so on, with earning money from industrial activities, from spinning, weaving, metal work, and so on. So that made them relatively, let's say, resilient against economic crisis and so on. I think if we compare it to today's putting out, yeah, to this home office work, that is much more dependent. It's much more dependent because the employer has much more control over the work process, over this remote work process, because the digital technologies they allow to enter into the house work, while in former times there was a long distance and control was not so easy. Yeah? So I would say that today's home workers are not in the same position as in the 18th century.
I see. Another thing I found really fascinating about your book called Work, the Last 1,000 Years, is the way you challenge the kind of Eurocentric narrative and bring into your book your research around how work was considered and understood also in Asia. So I was wondering, why was it important for you to bring this understanding of work that we have here in the West into a much broader perspective? And do you think also that things have changed, that with globalization, with industrialization of large parts of the world, that now we all understand work and we all share this Western viewpoint on work?
I mean, in my book, I have a very broad notion of work. So I do not only look at gainful employment, at work outside of the home, at the workplace, but I look at all activities that contribute to the survival of people. And in the course of history, most of these activities were carried out in the places where people were living. So living and work was not divided in the same way as it started when the factory system set up central places where people went to work, where people performed wage work. And from that moment onwards, so from the 19th century onwards, it was only this work performed in the factories outside, also, of course, in the offices or in the construction sites and so on, but outside the home, that was considered work, labor, hard labor, paid labor. But all the work that remained in the households and that remained in the households until today, although what is performed is changing, but there is a lot of work carried out in the households, in our apartments and houses and so on. But it was not considered work anymore because it was not paid. It was just seen as something additional. And it was very much related with the position of women. Instead of work, it was seen as something that was done out of love, of care, of the role as a mother or a wife, and it lost its character of work. And this was something that, of course, was carried out at the place in those regions where the factory system came first. So this was it was not only a Eurocentric, it was a Western-centric, an industry-centered perspective on work that only more or less wage work in the factory was considered work. And then, of course, this idea spread, it spread into regions where these work conditions did not exist, where people still worked in subsistence agriculture, in informal sectors, at low wage jobs that were rotating and so on. So where these factory jobs were not available, and also where the social security that developed with the factory jobs in the 19th century, partly because the employers wanted surviving workers and partly because the labor organizations fought for better working conditions and social security and so on, so that that wage labor went along with more and more welfare and so-called social security provided by private but also by state organizations. But that was not the case, let's say, in the colonies or also after colonization in the Third World. So people followed a model that was shaped by the West, but that did not correspond to their own experience at all. But let me come to the second part of your question when you said, with globalization, there's a kind of homogenization of work situations. No, I don't think so. I think we had a very sharp division of labor between the old industrial countries, the so-called developed countries, where the benefits or the profits of work remained and to a certain extent also were transferred to the workers, while in the Third World, in the former colonial world, people were allowed to work, but mostly did not have access to social benefits and stable positions and so on. But that changed, because when this new international division of labor came up, when industrial mass production was outsourced to places in the global south, then some of the countries in the global south, they changed they were successful in catching up. Yeah? So they became emerging economies. Yeah? China is a good example, but we can also take India, Brazil, South Africa, and so on. Yeah? And of course, they took over the idea, the labor ethics of capitalism. Yeah? But they were not used to this welfare system that the labor movement had established in the global north. Yeah? So they were still cheaper, although they had a, let's say, successful catching up process. Yeah? And by accepting these low wage conditions, they set a new model. Yeah? And this new model of cheap labor, if you want, that also exercises pressure on the labor regulations, on the welfare states in the, I would now say, in the former industrial countries, because the industrial mass production is outsourced to the global south. But it was not completely compensated by new knowledge industries and so on. Of course, there still is work to be done, labor to be done, but that is not anymore secured as it used to be in those years between, let's say, 1880 and 1980, when the welfare state became quite dominant in the global north.
Yes, it's. I found very interesting when you talk about the welfare state and social security, because now the picture seems to be a bit darker. There seem to be some deregulation of the labor market, the more and more precarious conditions for many workers. There is also this loss of the job for life that I know my parents really, really took for granted. And so it's difficult for people not to think of it better in the olden days. And if I bring my own experience into the discussion, I would say that for me, I cannot complain because the digital technologies have opened up new opportunities for people like me who are freelancers, who are writers, who are designers, who are thinkers or artists. On the other hand, things are getting difficult as well. So I was wondering, what's your perspective on that? Do you think we're in this really dark tunnel, we don't see the end of it, it's only going to get worse? Or do you see glimmers of hopes and movement that are trying to change things for the better?
I do not want to deny that digitalization also includes opportunities, but it depends from which perspective you look on it. I think what we now face is an extreme polarization, because digitalization requires, let's say, a small group of highly specialized workers who set up the whole machinery and the whole communication and so on, also for production, but also for life. Yeah? And then, of course, you have a lot of people who are pushed out of these stable lifelong jobs, as you said, which were typical for your parents because they lived in the global north. Yeah? So this was not typical for the global south, but there, these old, let's say, proletarians who could live on their wage and even have a family that could survive well on their wages, that is not for sure anymore. So they indeed lose something because but actually they adapt to a situation that was typical for most people in the world. So I would say precarity is back to the global north, and this precarity means that even the let's say the high-skilled workers live in a precarious situation, which might be no problem when they are young and have enough money to pay for their social needs and so on. But they can also lose their jobs, and we have to think that, I mean, these new digital jobs, they are, let's say, sold to us or promised to us as something that will pull everybody in this new, let's say, situation where you do not work so many hours anymore, where there's more flexibility, where there's a lot of social flexibility and the possibility to raise up your and improve your situation. But of course, this is not the case. I mean, behind every well-off job, you have a lot of servants, of workers, of much of this work is done by migrant workers who are ready to do almost everything for a low wage, especially if their let's say residence situation is unclear or illegal. Yeah? It depends. If I look at one person who is in a leading position, I can easily say that digital technologies open new opportunities. But if I look at all these slaves, I would say, or servants that supply these persons, and that you do not see because they are in the shadow of this of these glamour jobs, then I am not so optimistic about the future.
Okay, that's when I want to bring artificial intelligence into the conversation, because AI and other forms of automation that regard especially cognitive work are perceived as a threat. And we have the feeling that we will not, the machines are going to steal our jobs. That's the way it's often present. So do you think that work is going to acquire a new meaning, or maybe it will just disappear? Because I find it really difficult, you know, when I hear about artificial intelligence. On the one hand, there are people who say, oh, it's going to completely erase work and steal your job, and you will all be a mass of humans that have no ways to make a living, and it's a very, very dark picture. And then on the other hand, you have the optimistic who say, oh yes, you know, it happened with the Industrial Revolution, some jobs disappeared, but new jobs will be created. So in the end, there will be a balance again, you don't have to worry. So I was wondering, how do you feel in this debate?
On the one hand, of course, all this panic in the discussion of losing jobs, it reminds me, of course, of the situation in the 19th century when also the machines were killing the jobs and people were afraid and they were even breaking the machines in order to keep and maintain their jobs. But then, of course, there was a modernization, new branches came up and new needs were created also. So new jobs were there, and they didn't have to fear not to have an income. The difference today is that, of course, new branches also come. We live in a transition from, let's say, from the industrial age to the cybernetic age, and this is a long transition, of course, so we already can see the new branches, but they are still competing with these old in industrial system that, by the way, we also need, because we cannot just live on communication and information and so on, but we also need, let's say, material things to survive, various objects and so on. But of course, with digitalization and robotics and artificial intelligence and so on, you can rationalize more than with the old machines, and also the new jobs and new branches that come up. Maybe they do not offer as many working hours or need for workers anymore. But with my interpretation or definition of work, it is quite clear that work cannot disappear, no? Because it can only disappear if you only look at this, let's say, commodified world. But there's so much work done behind. Yeah? I mean, look at all the family life that is maintained by care work for the young, for the old, for the disabled, and so on. But also look at all the shadow work. This is a more modern category of work, yeah? That is extremely rising. Because, for instance, all the work that we are doing by e-commerce or e-administration or so we are substituting staff, employed people in the banks, in the offices, in the shops, and so on, that we replace by our own activity. I think that is also something. It doesn't really create values, but it lowers the costs for the employers, for the business owners. So this is also a part of work that is appropriated by capital, if I may say so, yeah, and that doesn't disappear. In the contrary, it is increasing. So almost all our existence is kind of, let's say, drawn into the world of labor. Yeah? Even if we do our exercises and so on, we improve our corpses. Even if we say care for our face or for our shape or for our children's career and so on. So we are working all the time. So I do not see it disappear. And I already mentioned all this service work that is done behind. For instance, if we do online shopping, how nice, we just call and then the things are in the fridge. Yeah? But who brings them into the fridge? Yeah? If I look at all these Pakistani and so on who are employed in this specific sector of the labor market in Vienna, in Cyprus, it's maybe, I don't know from where the migrant workers in these low paid sectors of the economy come. So I think this is the majority of work that will survive in any new society, if you want. And of course, there will be some others, the high skill knowledge workers and so on, who think that all this is not contemporary anymore because they are not looking at it. Yeah? They like a slave owner, he doesn't speak of his slaves, but he speaks of his creativity and so on. Yeah? But so I think the main question is not what will work disappear, but how much and which digital technologies do we want to develop, to use also for the, let's say, for the sake of society. Yeah? It's not easy because, of course, all this digital economy is very much under the control of its owners, yeah, of these new tech firms and so on. But I think they have to be included in a kind of social or public decision-making, what we need and what we reject. Huh? And then, of course, it's also the question is also about the distribution of work and labor. If in the end it should be possible that we may live on a lower number of employed working hours, that's fine. Huh? But that means that we have to distribute jobs evenly among the population and allow everybody access to these paid jobs to survive, but also to oblige everybody in the society to perform, I call it reciprocal work. So work that is done for the family, for the household, for the community, for the neighborhood, and so on, without pay, because you live on your job. Yeah? So I'm a supporter of a kind of split model, yeah? So that you have much lower, significantly lower working hours, I mean paid, sorry, it's always this mistake that comes in paid working hours, yeah, so that you have more time for non-paid activities that I also call work for the society, work for the community. And this has to be distributed in a completely new setting. And in this case, automation, of course, if it is able to save time for the reciprocal work and for the work for society, then I'm it's fine.
Thank you for your answer. So I just brought artificial intelligence and the other big actor for work right now is this pandemic, and the fact that it suddenly we found ourselves inside our home. And that's something also I discovered in the book Work, the Last 1,000 Years, is that in the West, before the turn of the 18th to the 19th century, there was no separation between the workplace and the living place. And yeah, until last year, would have found it impossible to believe and impossible to deal with. And yet we are here, we're at home, people who have children, they have to take care of the schooling of the children, who sometimes have to stay home as well. We have to work from home. We're lucky because now we have Zoom, we have all these online spreadsheets and digital instruments. Do you think this is going something that is long term, especially for office workers, that we're now on a road that is defined and we're just going to stay home even after the pandemic has ended?
That's a difficult question. I mean, first of all, it is important to see that you cannot transfer all labor into the home, because in some cases you need factories and other premises to do that work. So we shouldn't underestimate this amount of work that is done outside. I mean, it's not only the factories, it's also the whole, let's say, health system or hospitals and so on. They heavily rely, of course, on institutions where people go to work and where they cannot stay home. So it's a kind of privileged situation, maybe, to think that you can stay home and exercise your work. But then on the other hand, the question is if it is really an advantage to do homework. No? I mean, of course, in history, when there were no central premises or very few, it was kind of normal that you did also work for the market. In your own house, yeah, and combined it with the subsistence agriculture and care work that was carried out in the family. But this situation doesn't exist anymore. Now, of course, the homes do not, or in most parts of the world, the homes do not supply land, for instance, or gardens or tools and so on to live on your own subsistence. So you rely heavily on wages. But if now you do the homework, I would say, first of all, an advantage for the employer. He saves on rent costs, he saves on material costs. Yeah? I think it is even an advantage for the employer if the employee can combine this paid work with housework and care work, yeah? Because that allows to be present as a workforce, as a labor force, yeah? And for the employee, of course, some see it as a chance because they can work from home. But at the same time, it's a double burden, yeah? And it doesn't allow any workplace solidarity. I mean, one of the advantages of transferring work to the factories or to the construction sites and so on was the fact that people met. Yeah, and could speak together and negotiate their situation, improve their situation, make pressure on the state or on the employers to improve their situation. Now with this atomization in the home, I mean, you are completely dependent on your employer, and I think the fact that you are flexible, it is more a benefit for the employer that than for yourself. I mean, I wouldn't say that this is true for every person. For me, as a scientist, I can quite well work from home, and it doesn't make much difference than working from the university. But even there, it's something that is lacking enormously: the contact with the others, all this exchange that is taking place, and that cannot completely be replaced by these digital tools that we are using to communicate. That changes our communication, and I think it has a negative effect on the output also of our scientific work. I don't know how it is for a for an artist who maybe relies much more on being on his own or her own and concentrate on the piece of art. Anyhow, artists were never forced into offices or into factories or so for them it might not be a big change, but I would say for all these office jobs it's a big change, and it might seem to be an advantage to be at home, but at the end it's a kind of enclosure and it's a kind of prison.
Just to say something about what artists are feeling or people who work in creative context. No, it's not fun. A lot of artists work through collaborations. And just like what you said when you talked about the fact that the thinking and the work of a researcher or a scientist is also part of it is also informal with your colleagues. And it's the same for artists. I mean, I think the fact that I'm sure you experienced that, you know, we participate to a festival, to a conference, we have a panel, and now everything is online. And after that, you know, after one hour and a half of discussion on screen, you just want to continue the discussion in an informal way in a bar, or, you know, to have tea together or whatever. So, yeah, I think I have just one last question for you. And it's around the fact that the original version, so the version in German of your book was published in 2014. So that's already 7 years ago. And I was, like, the first thing I found when I read your book is that it was very relevant. And I was thinking, in 2014, all of these were already apparent, so I thought it's still very relevant today. But on the other hand, I was wondering, you're the expert, so do you think there are new tendencies, new ideas in the air, new directions, or even new understandings of works that you didn't see coming when you were writing the book?
As a social historian, I always look at change, and I know that change is coming slowly, it's only seldom that it's a rupture in the very moment where you can tell a situation changes from this to that. But I, for instance, many of the things that I expected and predicted, they come true. But what I did not expect is such a sharp rupture as we experience this with this COVID measurements. Because here you have, I mean, I do not want to discuss about the danger of COVID and so on, but in general, I would say it's highly exaggerated because it's not comparable to all these pandemics that we had with the Great Plague or with cholera or with the Spanish flu and so on, or with many other diseases that we face today, with malaria and Ebola and so on, that are really a high risk. I mean, the COVID risk is much lower, and to my mind, it is used for a transformation of the society that is already in course, in flow, but that can be accelerated. And I mean, one of the elements with regard to our discussion on work is that you have now with these lockdowns a suppression of the right to work, as an employer or as an employee. Yeah? And that, of course, that is an enormous destabilization of the society. And it it brings along an atomization of the people, be it as that they lose their jobs or that they are forced into home office. And I interpret this along the shifts that long-term shifts that I see, this push towards from the industrial age to the cybernetic age, to the age where artificial intelligence coordinates the work processes, and people become more and more just an appendix of the machines, and that of course is linked with new leading branches. So the fact that a lot of branches come under pressure and will go bankrupt after this government helps and so on run out, and after, let's say, inflation will bring new economic problems. But it's quite clear that this is also paving the way for the rise of new leading branches that we can already see in this pandemic quite clearly. It's the bio and the medical and also the control branches that gain ground. And I think this shift is contributing to a change of what it means to be a human. Because there are new man-machines symbioses that are developing. There is a much more control, I would say, a total control that is developing, not only about in the work process, as we already had it for a long time, where surplus labor is appropriated by the employer, where surplus value is appropriated. But now, I think with this new digital data, this economy that is relying on data, it's much more than just appropriating labor. It's a kind of appropriation of the human bodies as an object, as a subject of the economy, of human experience. So I think it's really an inclusion of the whole person into the system of commodification, and it is becoming a source of value appropriation, because by offering the data, the let's say the raw material of this new economy, it's not only the labor force, but it's the whole body and the whole human person that is exploited, I would say. And for me now, the exploitation of the human, and the change of what it means to be a human has become much more important than just the exploitation of labor, which doesn't end, of course. It's continuously the case, but I think it's a shift towards a much more total exploitation. But I do not want to say that all this has to come true, because history always meets obstacles and contradictions and so on. So I think it's very important to resist against these developments and not take them for granted. And I think in becoming aware of the, let's say, the importance of this situation, I think artists can play a much more important role than scientists, because scientists are only read in their small circles, and they argue in their old, let's say, forms. But by changing the form, you can also maybe put with your finger really in the wounds of this society and offer perspectives that might be utopian, but I think we need utopian perspectives in order to stop this development that is very useful for big parts of industry, of capital and so on, but I think we should put our own ideas against it.